Good evening, everybody. Welcome to St. Timothy's Anglican Church for A Royal Affair, Music for Royal Occasions. I'm the Reverend Canon Warren Manweiler. I'm rector here at St. Timothy's, and I'm also canon. That's a big deal, apparently, but doesn't matter to me. Canon for worship and liturgy in the Anglican Church in the Anglican Diocese of Edmonton. I'm honored to be joined by a treasured colleague and close friend, Dr. Joy Berg, who is department chair and director of choral activities at Concordia University of Edmonton, and she is director of music as well at our sister parish at the Anglican Parish of Christ Church. In addition, we're joined by some very talented musicians in our community, all of whom are listed in the program and whose artistry you're sure to enjoy. St. Timothy's Anglican Church respectfully acknowledges that our parish and people are located on Treaty 6 territory, a traditional gathering place for diverse Indigenous peoples, including the Cree, Blackfoot, Métis, Nakota Sioux, Iroquois, Dene, and the Ojibwe, Salto, Anishinaabe, Inuit, and many others whose histories, languages, and cultures continue to influence our vibrant community. We welcome, too, those who have joined us online on YouTube Live. You'll find a copy below, or rather a link below in the description to the video, below what you're watching, to a PDF copy of the program that you can download and print or use on another device for your reference. We also welcome your generous financial contributions to the musical and artistic life of this parish and our surrounding community, so that you can look forward to more musical and artistic events like these. A link to our parish website is also provided in the description underneath this video, and you'll find on our church website a light green Give button. Click that window, or click that button, and a window will pop up that will help you to make a receiptable contribution to tonight's concert and efforts. We know that live music during these COVIDian times, as we call them now, is a luxury and a delight that so many of us have realized is absolutely essential to our well-being. We're glad that those of you who are in attendance are safely distanced in your cohorts and that you also are masked. You'll even notice that even Anthony's trumpet has a mask on the end. He's going to hold that in the air. He got it on there. He took it off, but he's going to put it back on. Did you know that was a thing? He'll show you in a minute.
You need a drum roll.
You need a drum roll. Yeah. Ta-da! Ba-dum, boom. Okay. It might be very tempting as well tonight to hum or even to sing along with the music. I understand that fully. But we ask that so that this is a safe environment as possible for everyone, that those of you who are here present, please don't hum or sing along. It produces a lot of droplets. You can tap your foot, you can tap your thigh, you can tap the person next to you with their appropriate consent, if you like. But those of you at home, of course, you can sing and do whatever you like to your heart's content. A full and inspiring program awaits us. Would you in the audience and you at home please stand as we hear the national and royal anthems?
Oh, God. beloved classical works have served as worthy accompaniments for royal occasions over the centuries. Ask any patriotic Canadian what it means to be Canadian, and I'm sure someone, somewhere, will mention getting up in the very wee hours of the morning to watch a royal wedding, a funeral, or other monumental occasion. British royal occasions and the music that punctuates their grandeur and pageantry extends far, far earlier than gathering in the living room at 3 a.m. to watch a royal wedding. As a composer of the royal court, George Frederick Handel, a German, became Brit, and Lutheran became Anglican, kind of like that guy over there, spent the bulk of his career in London, becoming well known for operas, oratorios like Messiah, anthems, concertos for organ, and chamber orchestra. Just as well known and well regarded as Messiah are his water music and music for the royal fireworks, one to accompany a floating concert on the River Thames, the other to accompany the fireworks for an audience of over 12,000 in London's Green Park in 1749. Legend has it that Handel composed the water music to regain the favor of King George I. According to observers, the whole river, in a manner, was covered with boats and barges, the music lasting to well after midnight. We promise we won't keep you that long tonight, though. Among other court composers in this early period was Jeremiah Clarke, who served as organist and gentleman extraordinaire at the Chapel Royal. As cellist, Bavisha Kotecha plays a selection of works by Clarke from Handel's water music and music for the royal fireworks. Catherine Benoit and her brother Patrick will play two familiar works, also composed by Clarke and by Handel.
Thank you.
the vast empire on which the sun never sets and whose bounds nature has not ascertained. British imperial power spanned the globe and reached its zenith, its peak, by about 1913. Almost one quarter of the world's population at the time were held sway by the empire, with British imperial influence having an immense and widespread influence on the political, legal, linguistic, and cultural affairs of peoples and nations across the planet. Exploration, wars, colonization, immense wealth, dominant global power. All of these established Britain as the foremost world power, leaving a legacy of influence often now realized as contributing to order, but also to genocide, to national rebellion, to social and economic upheaval. And on our land, this land, their land, the forced assimilation, traumatizing, warehousing, stigmatizing, and immense suffering of indigenous peoples. It is a legacy that will take generations of careful, intentional, thoughtful, sensitive, and humble work and service to reconcile. Imperial music during this period was sheer pomp and circumstance. From Act 3, Scene 3 of Shakespeare's Othello, we read this: "Farewell the neighing steed and the shrill trump," not that one, "the spirit-stirring drum, the ear-piercing fife, the royal banner and all quality, pride, pomp, and circumstance of glorious war." Walton's Crown Imperial, composed for the coronation of King George VI in 1917, to Queen Elizabeth's coronation, was played there in 1953 on television, and serving as a recessional for the royal wedding of William and Catherine in 2011. Walton derived the march's title of Crown Imperial from William Dunbar's poem, In Honor of the City of London, a verse of which is printed in your program. Songs of empire, too, were common during this period. We all know the tune to Rule Britannia, even if you don't know the words or the title. Whenever a shot of Buckingham Palace appears on your TV screen, that's the soundtrack, and you'll recognize it. The modern hymn, O Day of Peace, written in 1987, is set to the tune of this era's composer, Hubert Parry's, rather, hymn, And Did Those Feet in Ancient Time. You might know it as simply Jerusalem. Themes of conquest, entitlement, and power are replaced with a longing for justice and goodness in that text of O Day of Peace, yearning for a day when all shall know the Lord.
occasions are happy occasions. The royal funerals of Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, and Diana, Princess of Wales, were no exception. National and global bereavement swept across the globe, both for the Queen and the national mother figure who had led a waning empire through two world wars. Diana, a controversial figure, without a doubt humanized the role and concept of royalty and used her royal privilege to bring attention to the plight of so very many, from AIDS victims to those suffering as a result of abandoned landmines. George Thalben Ball's Elegy was originally composed as an improvisation to fill time at the end of a BBC radio hourly broadcast. Eventually, his improvisation was put to paper and was played at Princess Diana's funeral. Bach's Fugue in E-flat served as part of the prelude at the funeral of the Queen Mother in 2002. The fugue explores the first measures of a tune that sound tremendously similar to the hymn, O God, Our Help in Ages Past. Three episodes of the fugue exposit the hymnic theme, all three episodes expressing that character of a person of the Trinity. You want to prick up your ears to hear first God the Father in sonorous and regal tones, the flight and dynamism of the Holy Spirit in the second part, the triumph of Christ in the third part, and then a rousing resolution at the end with all three fugue melodies expressing three divine persons in one Godhead.
royal. Having the status of a king or queen or a member of the royal family. I'm no William or Charles or Philip, and I never will be. So many little girls, styled in the usual pink and purple and blue sportswear, with their light-up LED runners, and branded as princess, will never really be royalty either. At least not in the sense of Britain or in the sense of empire. And maybe that's not such a bad thing. St. Peter, though, in his first letter in the New Testament, has this to say about you and me. To the princess-clad little girls, and even some darling little boys, and even to our friends, Elizabeth and Philip, William and Catherine, and all the other persons of great stature, and especially those with no seeming stature at all, who span this entire global home on which we live. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. At a time like this, when our routines and patterns of life are far less than glamorous and way less than regal for so many, God calls you and me to see ourselves and all the others around us as His royalty. The person and work of Jesus Christ, His coming to earth and taking on human form just like you, His life, His love, His suffering and death, His rising to life again, His ascension, still ascending, getting things ready. All these point to a God whose regal power is shown in the love and care and compassion of a humble Savior. You, my friends, all of you, and everyone behind me, you are all royal in God's sight. We may not wear the robes, or have the cash or power and the militaries of a British king or queen, but the King of all creation is our loving King, who shows us just how it is and how it was meant to be, that power, status, and privilege should be used in service to others, out of love. God grant you, in these concluding three works of the program, an abiding sense of your royalty in Jesus Christ, His loving and guiding presence in your life, especially these days. May His grace move you to see yourself in new and wonderful ways, and to see your relationships in the same light with others, new, fresh, and renewed. May He, too, keep you safe during times like these, and guard and keep you and all those whom you love.
much for joining us.